Welcome everyone to Citywide Medical Grand Rounds for today, September 19th, 2024. We have St. Joseph Healthcare Hamilton as the host site today, and we'll bring up the next slide.
Hold on. Oh, there we go.
We go. That's okay. And then we'll bring up the next slide. So we'll start with a land acknowledgement today as we kick off our medical grand rounds. We'd like to acknowledge that St. Joseph Healthcare Hamilton sits on the traditional territories of the Mississaugas and the Haudenosaunee Nations and is within the lands protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. This is a treaty between the Anishinaabe, Mississaugas, and Haudenosaunee that bound them to share the territory and protect the land. Subsequent Indigenous nations and peoples, Europeans, and all newcomers have been invited into this treaty in the spirit of peace, friendship, and respect. And we'll bring up the next slide, which I think is no conflicts of interest for our speakers today. And then we can bring up your title slide. So very excited to welcome as part of our Chief Medical Grand Round series, Drs. Al-Sufiani, Lee, and Stefanova, who are going to be presenting on the topic of rethinking uncomplicated Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia. And I'd like to also welcome my co-host today, Dr. John Neary, who is the Interim Clinical Teaching Unit Director over at St. Joe's presently. And I'm going to hand things over to Dr. Neary to tell us a bit more about our speakers today.
Thanks, Dr. Verhovsek. So as Dr. Verhovsek mentioned, our three presenters today are three of our teaching medical residents in their third year of residency at McMaster. In alphabetical order, Dr. Wala Al-Sufiani, who is originally from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and is applying for a fellowship in allergy and immunology next year. Dr. Julian Lee, who studied medical sciences at Western and a master's in applied clinical pharmacology at U of T, and who apparently fosters older dogs in his spare time. I may need to seek some advice from him because I adopted a six-year-old Bernese this weekend. And then finally, Dr. Isabella Stefanova, who is applying to infectious diseases, has a research interest on prescribing strategies in gram-negative bacteremia, and whose interests outside of medicine, including long-distance running, which I will certainly not ask her for tips about. Teaching medical residents, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much, Dr. Neary and Dr. Vasovic. I'm Julian. Nice to meet you guys. Isabella actually has an interview for infectious disease. So if anyone here is the infectious disease program director here at McMaster, I would recommend you take her. In any case, she may have to leave a little bit early while we're doing this presentation. But overall, the topic of our presentation today is discussing uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia. Our first objective is to understand the current principles in management and how this differs with complicated and metastatic bacteremia. Our second objective is to explore new evidence in uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia definitions, workup, and management. And we'll talk about two trials, one of which is an observational study on the role of diagnostic imaging, and the second is a non-inferiority randomized controlled trial called the SABATO trial. And then finally, we'll discuss how this new evidence affects current and future practice and maybe some next steps in research. So Wala is going to take it away first, and she'll talk to us about current and new classifications of Staph aureus bacteremia.
Okay, thank you, Julian, for the introduction, and thank you, everyone, for joining our presentation. Sorry for the overhead announcement. So I will start with an overview of current and new classification of Staph aureus bacteremia. Next slide, please. So as everyone knows, Staph aureus bacteremia is one of the most morbid infectious syndrome and is leading bacterial cause of death worldwide. It has remarkable heterogeneity in disease severity. Certain patients may recover quickly with therapy, whereas others develop multiple complications. Next slide, please. So traditionally, Staph aureus bacteremia has been described as complicated or uncomplicated. Such terminology use host factors and clinical course to direct treatment decision, but may not fully account for the range of Staph aureus bacteremia presentation. So the Staph aureus bacteremia classified as uncomplicated if we exclude any finding of endocarditis and there is no implant prosthesis, and also if there is a negative follow-up blood culture at day 2 and 4, and it shows clearance within 72 hours of antibiotics, and if there is no evidence of metastatic sites of infection. Regarding complicated, it's also called metastatic. If it's not meeting the criteria for uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia, it will be classified as complicated. Next slide, please. So for recently, expert has been argued a shift toward classify the infection or patient by risk for complication. Using this distinction to guide further diagnostic evaluation and ultimately treatment decision. So patient would be rather dislike classify as low risk for metastatic infection or high risk of metastatic infection. Next slide, please. So they use three different domains for this classification. The first domain is host factor, whether it has implanted prosthesis, IV drug use, or history of infective endocarditis. For feature bacteremia, the duration of bacteremia is an aspect, timing of positive blood culture, and if it's community acquired, and if there is any treatment delay, clinical course, whether there is persistent fever or known source of infection or signs of metastatic infection. Next slide, please. So the patient will have high risk for Staph aureus bacteremia if there is any suspicions of infective endocarditis and there is clinical signs of metastatic infection or implanted prosthesis, infective endocarditis, or history of IV drug use, and the blood culture are positive, continue to be positive for more than 40 hours of treatment, and delayed start in antibiotics or if there is any persistent fever. For low risk, if it's not meet the prescription of high risk, and in addition, if the bacteremia is hospital acquired, that's put patient under category of low risk for Staph aureus bacteremia. Next slide. Okay, this algorithm describe the proposed stratification, evaluation, and treatment plan. So patient with Staph aureus bacteremia should undergo minimal evaluation with thorough history, physical exam, repeated blood culture, and also a transthoracic echo. And based on our domains and factors we explained in the previous slide, patient will be stratified as low risk or high risk. For high risk or indeterminate risk, additional evaluation is performed based on the clinical finding with transesophageal echo, CT, MRI spine, and also PET scan. We start the antibiotic treatment and to choose the agents based on the sensitivity of Staph aureus bacteremia. If it's MRSA, then the vancomycin will be standard, daptomycin will be considered as a second option. For methicillin sensitive, cefazolin, and with consideration also of daptomycin. If there is persistent bacteremia and there is concern of antibiotic failure, a combination of therapy can be considered with daptomycin and ceftriaxone. And if there is unable to complete the first line of antibiotics, patient can be undergo long acting infusion or step down to oral therapy. For the duration, if it's low risk or uncomplicated, the duration for antibiotics treatment will be 14 days. If it's complicated or high risk, will be 4 to 6 weeks. And also the effective management or source control is part of the effective management. So if the patient has any drainable abscess or septic arthritis, has to undergo a drainage and extract any implanted devices. Temporary central line can be also removed. And if there is any also a difficult implant to be removed, then monitor any sign of infection for this implant, such as valvular prosthetic heart valve or implant or orthopedic implant. And also assessing substance use disorder for the patient. This algorithm is emphasized on the importance of patient-centered decision-making. So during the inpatient, we treat the patient with methadone to avoid any withdrawal symptoms, and also refer patient as to outpatient harm reduction service to ensure that a patient is cleared for infection and prevent any reinfection. Next slide.
Thanks so much.
Okay, go ahead.
All right. I don't know why my video is off. First, I couldn't speak, and now I can't be perceived. So I'm sorry that you can't see my face. I don't know how to fix it. But I'm Isabella, and I'll be talking. Oh, now I can turn on my camera. Thank you. Okay, now I think you'll be able to see me. So I'm Isabella. I'll be talking about this observational study on diagnostic imaging in low-risk Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia. In particular, the reason I wanted to highlight this study was because I think we can all relate when you have a patient with Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia, you get a transthoracic echo, indeterminate, and then you say, okay, I guess, do we need an TE now? And it's this whole debate. And maybe nothing has ever been found from this, or does it actually change management? I don't know. But this study is an interesting discussion on that. And I do apologize, like Julian said, I'll have to leave a little bit early because I have an interview coming up. Next slide, please. So the clinical question in this study, what they wanted to study was people with low-risk Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia, which they defined very well. What they meant specifically was that the bacteremia was hospital-acquired, treated basically immediately with resolution of the bacteremia and defervescence within 48 hours, and the patient had no prostheses. This is pretty in line with the definition of low-risk Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia that Walla described already, so not very surprising there. The intervention was essentially if diagnostic imaging was performed, for example, echocardiography or PET, but there were other types of diagnostic imaging. And the comparator group was whether no diagnostic imaging was performed. Something I really want to highlight here is that the diagnostic imaging was not limited to echo. And in particular, it was not limited only to TTE or TEE. There were also patients who got PET CT scans, who got CT chest abdo-pelvis, or who got just regular ultrasonography, for example, to look for a DVT or something. So this was not limited only to echocardiograms. The outcome primarily was the proportion of patients who had a change in treatment plan due to the detection of some kind of metastatic infection from these routine diagnostic imaging. And by change in treatment plan, this meant that the duration of the antibiotics changed, or perhaps the type of antibiotic changed, or perhaps the source control of some kind was necessary. Next slide, please. So who was included and excluded? I alluded to this a little bit, but this study was performed in adults above the age of 18. It included the low-risk Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia, which I already described. And it was looking at patients who had this between January 2013 and 2022. Notably, patients were excluded, of course, non-adults, those who passed away or became palliative within 72 hours of the blood cultures being found positive, patients who had contaminated blood cultures. And I want to highlight here a practice variation from us in North America that in this study, they deemed the blood culture to be contaminated if only one of the two cultures was positive for Staph aureus. So I just want to highlight that because the practice in North America is that's not the case. In North America, if one culture is positive for Staph aureus, it is considered true bacteremia, even if technically it could be contaminant, but we're not going to get into that at this time. I just want to make an important note here about that, because while I don't think it weakens the study, I actually think it strengthens it. It's just a variation from what we do here, perhaps at MAC. They also excluded polymicrobial bacteremia, since, of course, that might not be only related to the effect of Staph aureus, and those who were transferred immediately to another hospital were also not excluded. Next slide, please. Sorry, we're also excluded, as I meant to say. So the design of the study, like I mentioned, it was a retrospective cohort study. It was observational. This was not an RCT. And it took place in 7 hospitals in the Netherlands only. So this was limited to one country, and in particular, this is a European country. As you can imagine, you can probably draw some conclusions from the different kind of population that they have and the different kind of practices that they have compared to us here in Canada. They did follow the patients for up to 90 days after antibiotic discontinuation. And they did also look a bit into infection recurrence and mortality within those 90 days. However, I will not be focusing on that in regards to discussing the study, just because it's not my primary message I wanted to get across. As you can see here, this graph demonstrates those who were excluded, and it is, you know, in keeping with the exclusion and inclusion criteria that I mentioned before. Next slide, please. So in terms of the patient characteristics, there were 377 patients included, and the majority of these did get diagnostic imaging, more than those who did not get diagnostic imaging. One thing I want to note, 377 patients maybe seems perhaps a bit low, but I do want to emphasize this is actually more patients than in the RCT Julian will speak about. So it is pretty sizable. Another thing I want to highlight is, well, how come there were actually 46 patients who did not get any kind of diagnostic imaging? Because at least at our institution, the standard of care is that every single patient with this bacteremia will get a TTE. I will say that I'm not 100% sure why these patients did not get an echocardiogram. I wonder whether there is some practice variation regionally, but that is one question that I bring up. Another thing that I would really like to highlight, which I've highlighted with the red box, the second two red boxes, is that there were absolutely no patients who had MRSA, and there were absolutely no patients who were IV drug users. As you can imagine, this brings into question the generalizability of these results, especially at least at our center, since very frequently we do see these populations having Staph aureus bacteremia. Something I want to highlight in the baseline differences in the patient characteristics is that if a patient was consulted by an ID physician, they were more likely actually to get some kind of diagnostic imaging, and this was statistically significant. That's another practice variation that I identified. I know that at least at our site, it is a mandatory ID consult when someone has Staph aureus bacteremia. And finally, just wanted to note that the most common portal of entry in both of these groups was phlebitis. Next slide, please. So in terms of the actual diagnostic imaging, the majority of patients did have diagnostic imaging performed. And most commonly, as you might guess, I'm not surprised personally, it was a transthoracic echocardiogram, closely followed by transesophageal echocardiogram, and closely followed afterwards by PET CT, which perhaps we don't see that frequently at our sites. Afterwards, there were some other kinds of diagnostic imaging, which I don't really want to ignore because it is something I want to highlight in the discussion after. CT scan was quite frequent, in particular CT abdopelvis, CT chest. There was also MRI performed, and notably, there was frequently just regular ultrasonography performed, and that was typically looking for DVT or just thrombophlebitis. What was noted was that if the patient had an ID consult or was admitted to ICU, this was associated with increased imaging use. Next slide, please. So what was found actually, interestingly, was that imaging results led to a change in therapy in only about 4.7% of patients. And that big arrow that I'm showing you here is highlighting actually that most of the times this was because a superficial phlebitis or infected thrombus was identified with the use of regular ultrasonography. So It might be a bit small to see, but most of the imaging that you see here was not actually transthoracic echocardiogram that was identifying some kind of endocarditis. There's only one case there, number 11, where transesophageal echocardiogram did identify native valve endocarditis, but pretty much all of these, the reason there was a change to the management was because of the identification of infected DVT. And I also want to highlight that the change in therapy was only indicated in 1.3% of these. So perhaps there was even some like overtreatment as well. Next slide, please. So I do think that the results of this study is very interesting, but there are quite a few limitations, of course. First of all, we can't ignore that this is an observational study. Of course, we can't really draw complete conclusions from this because of confounders that perhaps we were not able to identify. So an RCT would be more helpful here. As well, I kind of alluded to this, but this was performed only in the Netherlands. So the generalizability of the study to different populations, such as perhaps our own in Canada, may be limited, especially since in this specific study, there was no MRSA, there was no IV drug use. As well, Staph aureus was only considered contaminant if it was in one of two blood cultures, which is not the practice here. However, theoretically, if they actually included this group in the study, it would have strengthened their study further. So I don't think that's necessarily a big limitation. And finally, what perhaps I think is the most significant limitation is that they assigned equal weight to all of the diagnostic modalities. So TTE, TEE, PET-CT, everything. Even though these all likely vary in their sensitivities. Next slide, please. So the bottom line, what I think about this study is that low risk Staph aureus bacteremia may not actually require routine diagnostic imaging like we previously thought, which is based on the current guidelines. In particular, a case I can think of where this is really applicable and relevant, I'm sure we have all seen this case, is we have a patient that's been admitted to the hospital for a very long time, is stable, all of a sudden develops hospital-acquired Staph aureus bacteremia from perhaps a peripheral IV or a forgotten PICC line or something like that. And all of a sudden they need to have another $1 million workup. This extends their length of stay, perhaps affects disposition planning, et cetera. When in fact, in the first place, perhaps your suspicion for metastatic infection was quite low in the first place. I think that depending on the results of future studies, this can actually shorten lengths of admission. It can reduce the cost of unnecessary diagnostic imaging. And it would really emphasize actually the importance of the clinical exam as affecting our suspicion of metastatic infection in this bacteremia. Next slide, please. So I'll hand it over to Julian now.
Thanks so much, Isabella. So, you know, Isabella's study had talked a bit about how we investigate these patients. And so the next thing we want us to talk about is how we can better manage these patients. And the Sabato trial was a trial looking at the efficacy and safety of early oral switch in low-risk Staph aureus bacteremia infections. It was an international open-label parallel group randomized control non-inferiority trial. And essentially, thesis of this study was to really look at patients, again, in this low-risk category. And in their article, they actually described them as very low-risk with uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia across 19 academic sites in Europe. There were four countries. Their intervention was about an early oral therapy switch from parenteral therapy after 5 to 7 days. Many of us know that the standard of care is mostly 14 days of IV therapy. But we know that, you know, trying to arrange for 14 days of IV therapy itself can have some limitations in terms of feasibility, in terms of access to IV medications in the community, and does have associations with IV complications themselves. Their outcomes were two parts. First was safety and efficacy, and their primary endpoint was something they called staph-associated bacteremia complications over 90 days. And the way that they stratified or they came about with this was either recurrence of the infection or any kind of staph associated bacteremia mortality. And the way they defined that was a positive blood culture within 72 hours of the mortality event. Their secondary outcome was looking at length of hospitalization stay, IV therapy complications, C. diff, which is always something that we think about whenever we're thinking about antibiotics, as well as survival and all-cause sort of mortality at 2 weeks, 1 month, and 3 months. The inclusion criteria is somewhat similar to the previous definitions of uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia, as we talked about before. These patients had to be over the age of 18. They had to have at least one blood culture with Staph aureus, and this included MRSA patients as well. IV therapy needed to be started within 72 hours of the first blood culture result, with a total of 5 to 7 days of IV therapy prior to randomization. And the way that the randomization was sort of flagged is that the microbiology lab would get the result of the blood culture, they would trace it back to the patient, and then that result would be forwarded to the research group. Repeat blood cultures had to be 24 to 96 hours after the IV therapy had to be negative. And then the rest of the inclusion criteria is basically trying to make sure that they were excluding anything that was potentially confounding or uncomplicating. So temperature had to be less than 38 for 48 hours. IV therapy, so IV catheters had to, that were not removed within 4 days of the first blood culture, those patients were excluded as well. And then patients with high baseline risk, as Walla talked about in sort of that high risk category, were also excluded. And these included, again, patients with IV drug use, immunodeficiency or immunosuppression, patients with a life expectancy of less than 3 months, or patients on more than one agent in the combined therapy, whether that be because of polymicrobial reasons or other coverage reasons. Similar to previous studies, it was signs and symptoms of complicated Staph aureus bacteremia patients were not included. This included things like endocarditis, empyema, pneumonia, undrained abscesses, or sepsis within 4 days prior to randomization. Importantly, the initial SABATO trial criteria in the protocol excluded patients with prosthetic valve and implanted prosthesis. However, there was an amendment after about 12 months after they did REB approval that then, included these patients with prosthetic valves as long as they were able to definitively prove through imaging that prosthetic infection was not a cause of this person's bacteremia. The study design, again, was across four different countries, 19 academic sites in Germany, the Netherlands, Spain, and the UK. It was a one-to-one randomization. It was an observer-blinded study, but as you can imagine, patients that were either on oral or IV therapy pretty much knew what they were getting, because oftentimes patients on oral therapy would have been discharged home rather than patients that were on IV therapy that had to stay in hospital. I think one of the strengths of the study is that they actually had an approved list of different antibiotics for these patients, but allowed providers a lot of flexibility into what they wanted to choose. They shot for an inferiority margin of both 5 and 10%. And they also did a intention to treat as well as a per protocol analysis, as well as a sensitivity analysis that was performed. So on the right, you'll see sort of what their workflow looked like. The first thing that was triggered was there was a positive blood culture for Staph aureus. These patients were screened. They had 5 to 7 days of IV therapy and then they were randomized. OST refers to oral. IST refers to IV, and there was a total duration of 14 days. And then there was out-of-hospital sort of follow-up up to days 85 to 99, and they looked at, again, mortality at 3 months' time at their longest length. In terms of the patients that they were able to recruit, similar to what Isabella said or Dr. Stefanova said, they actually, so they screened 5,000 patients, and quite a large proportion of them were actually excluded from the trial, and only about 213 were included for randomization. This sort of highlights that, uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia is actually quite a small subset of the total number of cases here. But they did do this one-to-one randomization. Again, you see 108 assigned to the oral switch, 105 assigned to your normal standard of care. But when you get down to the bottom of a clinically evaluable population or the per protocol analyses, you have 86 patients in the oral switch and 79 patients in the IV group as well. In terms of the patient characteristics themselves, you'll see on the right here that there is a table that they do, again, they did two different analyses. They did an attention to treat as well as a per protocol. One of the things that you actually notice is that the oral switch group was actually somewhat more comorbid. They had more incidence of liver disease, ESRD, and diabetes as compared to the IV group. although these differences were not significantly different to each other. The other thing that you'll also notice is that there are a lot more males in the MRSA, sorry, in this study as compared to females. The study didn't comment exactly why they felt that this was the case, and I'm not actually sure exactly why either. In terms of Staph aureus complications, which was the primary outcome, both intention to treat and per protocol analyses didn't show a significant difference in their primary endpoints, and both of them actually met the 10% non-inferiority cutoff. Interestingly, both of the deaths that occurred were in the oral switch group. One of them was because this patient was found, like on follow-up, this patient was found to be decompensating, however, refused further care, refused to come to the hospital. They didn't give any details about what the second death looked like. And they didn't provide any further details as to what the actual patient, antibiotic, sensitivities were for those patients, which would have been interesting. But overall, the study did meet its primary outcome of a 10% non-inferiority cutoff in both intention to treat as well as per protocol analyses. If you look at the forest plot here, you'll notice that it's sort of a visual representation of that. They did a 5% and 10% margin. The per protocol analysis did meet that 5 and 10% margin, but the intention to treat did not. And that sort of is in line with how the methodology is done. And the secondary endpoints were looking at length of hospitalization stay, complications from IVs, as well as survival. In terms of length of hospitalization stay, I don't think it surprises anyone that patients in the oral group were not in hospital as long, and it was about 4 days. This was statistically significant, and it shouldn't surprise most of us that IV complications were significantly more common in patients in the IV group. And numerically, it's about double. So in the intention to treat group, you can see that any complications from IV is about 9, and those from the IV group were about 17, and that proportion is sort of reflected in the per protocol analyses that you can see on the right hand side. There was no significant difference and numerical difference in C. diff in the intention to treat group, and again, no significant difference in those in the clinically evaluated group. And survival wise, while there was no significant difference at 14, 30, or 90 days either. So overall, the authors concluded that oral therapy after 5 to 7 days of IV therapy in patients for uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia treatment was non-inferior to 14 days of IV therapy, which was standard of care. Patients stayed on average about 4 days less in hospital with less IV complications. However, patients on oral therapy did have higher rates of serious events, namely non-staph infections, although both and that in the oral group, both staph-associated deaths occurred in the oral group as well. I think that's actually a very well-done study. One of the things I really enjoyed about it is that it has a very flexible and pragmatic approach to antibiotic treatment. It wasn't very prescriptive in saying that you can only use, this antibiotic for these patients. It allowed a lot of prescriber flexibility in ensuring that it was more generalizable to their population overall. I think the use of a per protocol and an ITT with a sensitivity analysis does show robustness of the results overall. And one of the things I really enjoyed was how strict actually the criteria for Staph aureus bacteremia that was uncomplicated was. They really wanted to show that these results were robust in a very specific group of patients. But at the same time, that can mean that there are some drawbacks with the generalizability of this trial. One of the other things that was pointed out is that, of the 5,000 patients that were initially enrolled, only really 200 patients sort of fit this group. And so, it really does show that further studies need to be had about how we can best manage and maybe expand how we can, or the risk tolerances that we have for patients that we want to switch to oral. There was no patient blinding. Obviously, patients with IV therapy were staying in hospital. And the other thing is that only 16 patients had MRSA were included, and it really doesn't show a lot of generalizability. And IV drug use patients, whether that be current or previous, were not included in the study. One of the things that I would have really loved was comments on the characteristics of those that did have staph-associated complications. What kind of antibiotics were they on? what was this, you know, what was the susceptibilities of those patients with Staph aureus? What was the follow-up like for those patients? Because those would really be able to help us determine, you know, was there some kind of barrier to oral therapy that may have compromised some of their care? So their bottom line was study results were generally best applicable to a small subset of uncomplicated, low risk or very low risk Staph aureus bacteremia patients. They felt that continuing IV therapy while investigations were ongoing to rule out deep-seated infections and complications of Staph aureus bacteremia was reasonable, but that after you've done all those things and after 5 to 7 days of IV therapy, that oral therapy was reasonable and safe for patients overall. Given the fact that one of these patients did have decompensation on follow-up, although they did pass away because they refused further care, they stressed the need for ongoing close monitoring and that ID should be involved in these patients as much as possible. I'll pass it over to Wala.
Thank you, Julian. So in this section, we'll speak with a few current controversies in Staph aureus bacteremia in terms of evaluation and treatment. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah, thank you. Previous. Okay. So the first area of controversy is how frequent we should do follow-up blood cultures. So single positive culture after starting therapy is a poor prognostic signs and with mortality increase with each day of culture positivity. According to the 2011 guidelines, the blood culture should be taken at day 2 and 4 and as needed thereafter. There is some general practice stop obtaining blood culture once they are they clear, but the some patient will have intermittent negative blood cultures prior to complete clearance. This is called the skip in a phenomena. Next slide. So the other area is when are anti-staph penicillin preferred compared with the civazolin for definitive treatment for MSSA? It's anti-staph penicillin is considered first-line treatment for MSSA endocarditis with civazolin listed as an alternative. This is according to American Heart Association, but it has historically, it's also been preferred in patients with central nervous system. So anti-staph penicillin are associated with higher rate of treatment-limiting toxicity and more frequent dosing schedules. So there is recent observational data suggests similar efficacy or even a trend towards a superiority of civazolin over anti-staph aureus penicillin. Next slide. So the other area of controversy is the duration of the treatment of Staph aureus bacteremia. So it's 4 to 6 weeks for a complicated or high risk group and 2 weeks for uncomplicated or low risk group. Optimal duration is open to debate. And there are two currently researchers are conducting to search about the, to answer this question, what is the optimal duration for the treatment of Staph aureus bacteremia? Next slide. So the first trial is the SAP7 trial. It's randomized, non-blinded, and multi-center. This study is currently addressing whether 7 days of antibiotics treatment is non-inferior to 14 days of antibiotic treatment for patients with low-risk Staph aureus bacteremia. And also, there is another trial, it's SAFE trial. It's multi-center, open-label, parallel group, randomized controlled trial. Currently conducting in Netherlands, they enrolling adult patients with complicated MSSA bacteremia and randomizing them to receive either 4 or 6 weeks of IV therapy. So what is the future directions? the next slide. Yeah, there are many open questions, and designing of RCT for Staph aureus bacteremia is challenging due to the requirement for antimicrobial registry and also the cost and the inherent heterogeneity and complexity of the syndrome. And there is a big launch of a platform. It's called SNAP. Next slide, please. So this is a network involved patients and microbiologists and ID physicians, researchers also, and hospitals around the world. It's launched in February 2022. It's first of its kind and largest to date. It's recruiting adults, pediatric, and youth, and aim to improve treatment outcome for a patient with Staph aureus bacteremia. This study includes multiple sites, including Canada, with potential to expand to other regions. Next slide. So this is the website for the SNAP trial. It also provided information to the health care physician, a member of the public, and also patients with more information about Staph aureus bacteremia.
Okay,
thank you.
We're happy to take any questions. Hopefully you guys can, how do I say this? Appreciate this pun. but yeah, we are happy to take any questions. Isabella might have to peel off because she has an interview. Good luck, Isabella.
Seeing that no one else has questions so far, I'll ask the first one. Thanks, Julian and Wala, for an excellent rounds, and of course, Isabella as well. Oh, that's a good one. So I noticed in the second trial, in the trial that was presented, you know, there were, besides the usual exclusions that we're all used to, you know, the things that were necessary on clinical grounds, but also, you know, pregnancy, current breastfeeding, you know, possibility of becoming pregnant, the new sort of pan exclusion criterion for all clinical trials, especially in this domain, seems to be current intravenous drug use. You know, I'm wondering why. I mean, I can understand that, you know, people with Staph aureus bacteremia associated with intravenous drug use are different in important ways from those without. You know, they may have longer durations of bacteremia, be more likely to have complications and so forth. But why is it okay to not gather data on this population, you know, that also needs evidence that directly informs their care?
I would absolutely echo your sentiments. I think that part of me feels that it is adding additional stigmatization towards these patients. My thought as to why that it was included in these trials in particular is because that the criteria itself was already so strict. And I think given the high morbidity and mortality of Staph aureus bacteremia itself, they didn't take a lot of risks in terms of the population that they wanted to include. Because even in the initial protocol for the Sabato trial, again, like Wallace mentioned earlier, the uncomplicated Staph aureus bacteremia definition doesn't include patients with prosthetic valves or implanted prostheses, but in the Sabato trial, they did. So I think that was actually quite good, but I agree with you. Dr. Shagla has his hand up, so maybe we can throw it over to him.
Zane? Do I need to unmute him?
Yes, you'll have to allow
him Mike.
To
okay, Zane, go
there
ahead.
There you go.
Thanks, guys. Great presentation. I think important, and I agree with you that you know, I think pragmatically and just thinking through these trials, like these are not the patients that cause us the most trouble in that sense, right? Like these are usually well-defined patients. I think there's definitely some validity, particularly outside of the academic setting when we're dealing in community settings, where, you know, extra keys may not be there, and oral therapy, especially for rural remote patients, may be much more tolerable than IV in shorter courses, more than longer courses. But I agree. I mean, the bigger question is, you know, what's the duration of optimal therapy and appropriate investigations for someone with people who use IV drugs that acquire Staph aureus bacteremia? Because that's a population where we really struggle, and I think we have to make decisions that are challenging both for providers but for patients and care. And you know, and unfortunately, the studies would suggest that if you walk in as a PWAD with Staph aureus bacteremia, there is a high risk of metastatic complication. So, you know, limiting investigations may not be ideal in that context. You know, I think that the question to you guys is, in the, you know, St. Joe's and Hamilton Health Sciences setting, would you be and again, a little bit of a contrast to Europe, where, you know, IV antibiotics home care is not as robust, and IV antibiotics actually lead people to stay in hospital, even if they're completely stable and well. Would you be comfortable making the switches? Would you be, you know, would you find there's a significant benefit to making switches? You know, or, you know, is the findings of these two studies really just, you know, not necessarily much different than current practice, or not much more benefit than current practice in that sense?
I'm happy to answer that, but I know that we have another person that had their hand up.
Why don't you take that question first, Julian, and then, sure. Then I'll go to Dr. Johnstone.
Yeah, sure. I think that one of the things that I'm actually going to pull up the, so I have the, so this is sensitivity. This is our subgroup analyses of the Sabato trial. So in relation to what you're asking, Dr. Shagla, I think that ultimately speaking, there's still a lot of discussion of whether or not it is something I would be comfortable with. And it's a discussion with the patient about, you know, the risks and benefits of continuing with oral therapy versus IV therapy, understanding if it is, you know, sending IV therapy something that we'll be able to do robustly for whatever social situation that they have. But the subgroup analyses that they ran, to me, put even more restrictions on whether or not I feel comfortable with oral antibiotics or an oral antibiotic switch. So in particular, it's patients over the age of 65, patients with, you know, a central venous catheter, or even skin and soft tissue infections, they didn't, like, the confidence intervals went over that sort of 10% non-inferiority threshold. And especially in patients with MRSA, it was like, this is probably not a good idea. But I what I would say is, you know, if this patient does not want to stay in hospital, then any antibiotic treatment would be better than none. So I would then say, you know, these are the risks associated with it. You know, we are outside of the realm of what the data is able to inform us, at least at this current time. As long as we have close follow-up with you, as long as you're understanding of those risks, then sure, that's something that we'll move forward with.
Next up is Dr. Rochelle Johnstone from Infectious Diseases. Rochelle, you're muted. You can't unmute. Let me hang on. I enabled your mic. You should be able to unmute at this point. If not, I'm going to blame Microsoft Teams. Is Dr. Crowther on the call? Rochelle, I wonder if you could put your question in the Q&A, then I can read it out. I'm sorry about that. While Dr. Johnstone is maybe doing that, I got a question. Let me see if I can take over share here.
I don't know if you're able to. Was there a specific slide that you wanted to take a look at?
No, it's not. It's not one of your slides.
Okay.
Yeah. I got a question for Dr. Chagla. Oh, no, never mind. I can't share my screen right now. Okay. Well, I was looking at the SNAP trial website and it has a map of all the locations it's going on. And if you zoom right in, it's like a Google map. There's two pins in Hamilton. There's Hamilton General and Jervinski. And I was wondering if anyone from St. Joe's can speak to whether St. Joe's is going to be a site.
Yeah, we're actually doing our site initiation visit at the end of the month, so we're going to be active
Sweet.
very soon.
That's great. I still wait. I'll keep an eye out for Dr. Johnstone's question if she is able to enter it. And again, I'm sorry about that. I have Teams is telling me that your mic is enabled, but that's not where. Okay, here we go. So from Dr. Johnstone, I wonder what the generalizability of the Sabatose step down options. Their oral step down was Deceptra 1 double strength tablet BID or clindamycin or linezolid. In our practice, we more often would step down to a combination with a beta lactam for MSSA, which makes up 75% of infections, even in people who inject drugs. So, Julian and Wallah, how would you, could you comment on the generalization of, their findings to our setting, given that our antibiotic choices tend to be quite different?
I think it means that it's not as generalizable. So this slide, it shows the, like Dr. Johnson said, sort of the antibiotics that they did step down to. I would instinctively say that if we are adding more than one agent in the oral step down group, then perhaps then we are going to run into less issues with patients having staph-associated bacteremia sort of complications, in which case potentially that means that we might have a little bit more success for these patients stepping them down. Ultimately speaking, they did exclude patients that were on more than one agent. I think the main reason for that was because they wanted to make sure that there was no polymicrobial issues, but I don't think that that is necessarily the most generalizable, finding, or sorry, generalizable guideline. I don't know if guideline is the right word, but generalizable characteristic, I would say, because patients with Staph aureus bacteremia, if they have other risk factors, are going to be at risk for other polymicrobial infections. So, I agree with Dr. Johnson's comment. It's definitely something that can be considered in further trials moving forward. Yeah. Wallah, do you have anything to add to that? And Dr. Neary, you're muted, unfortunately.
I muted myself. Are there any other questions from, I see we have 37 attendees, and that I'm sure is an underestimate because many of them are groups. And also as a question, I can hopefully unmute or enable your mic or read out a question if you put it into the Q&A. Seeing none, I think we will remarkably end Grand Rounds a little bit before 1 p.m. Thank you, Julian Lala, for an excellent presentation, and as well to Isabella. And I hope we'll see most people back at Grand Rounds next week. Going to try to end this for everyone now.
Thanks so much for coming. Have a great day.